Hey everybody and welcome, and in this video I want to break down basic geometry. And basic geometry is plane geometry, it's often called, and it was first described in Euclid's Elements, which was really just an aggregation of different work by other mathematicians prior to its writing. But here we finally had a text that kind of aggregated everything together and became the resource of reference, the most popular and widely recognized text on geometry. And there's other work in there as well, not just geometry. But basic geometry is a study of lines, segments, points, surfaces, planes, basically just two-dimensional shapes and polygons that are not overwhelmingly complex. And some examples might be the study of triangles, the study of squares, the study of circles, hexagons, trapezoids, etc. And now with geometry, it's all about taking a handful of axioms and postulating some characteristic or property of the shape. For example, Pythagoras found that what we call the Pythagorean theorem, where if we have a triangle, and specifically a right triangle, that if we know two of its sides, let's say A and B, we can find this third side, C, by applying a formula that has been geometrically proven, a theorem that has been proven. And that formula you probably recognize as A squared plus B squared equals C squared. And now this formula, as simple as it may be, is widely applicable and useful across many different areas and physical systems we can use it. For example, we can find the distance between any two points just by applying this theorem. For example, if we know A and B, we can find the distance C from one point to another. It's used as the basis of trigonometry, and it's used in other geometric proofs. And the list really just goes on and on. And in fact, in this video, I will do a geometric proof of the Pythagorean theorem to showcase how cool plane geometry can really be. And then lastly, I want to mention analytic geometry, which is a completely different area than plane geometry. And some people can get it confused, but this really is concerned with the graphical coordinates to showcase two-dimensional shapes. And it was really pioneered by Rene Descartes. Analytic geometry is different than plane geometry that was described in Euclid's Elements, and that is widely studied today. So with that, let's jump right into the proof for the Pythagorean theorem. Okay, and so we can run through the geometric proof for the Pythagorean theorem, and it was discovered around 1200 AD by a mathematician named Bhaskara. And there are other geometric proofs, but this one is my favorite because of its visual appeal. And it makes plane geometry seem cooler than you may have thought. And so let's get right into it. What Bhaskara did was he took a square. So I'll draw a square here. Wow, that's a little too crooked. We have a square that we've rotated slightly, so it's easier to see once we do some of the manipulations. And so we have a square here. And how do we know this is a square? We can put these tick marks here, indicating that each side is exactly the same length. If one side was longer than the other or shorter, you could put a second tick mark indicating that this side is different than the other three. But for our square, that's not the case. Then we could put this right here, indicating that each corner is exactly 90 degrees. And so this is a fundamental property of a square. Each angle is 90 degrees. And so once you have this, we know that we are dealing with a square. This is a square. And with the square, we could say that this side is C and this side is C. So the area of the square would be area would equal C times C equals c squared. And I use c, you'll see in a moment, purposefully. And so here we have c times c squared, the area. You're familiar with the formula. Okay, so then what Bhaskara did was he made right triangles throughout the square. He put in right triangles just like this. There we go. Here are the right triangles. Oops. And again, how do we know that these are in fact right triangles? Well, we can put our squares in, indicating where the 90 degrees are. So here we have a 90 degree angle, part of this right triangle. We have a 90 degree angle right here, part of this right triangle. And then a 90 degree angle here, and a 90 degree angle here. So now we have made our right triangles within this square. And they're all the same throughout. And we can label each side. So we know that this side is C. This side right here is C. Let's label this side right here. So this side right here, all for all of these triangles will be B. And then using a different color, we'll use blue. This side here on all of the triangles will be side A. So the same thing is on this side, right? This side right here is A. We already know that this is C. And then we know now that this side here is B. Cool, so now we have labeled our sides. Bhaskara then took this triangle here, this guy right here, and he moved it to this side of the square. So we can go ahead and draw that. So we have side A. We'll draw side A first. Side A is right here, this side, right? This guy. Go just right here. He put it. So it's the same as this, side A. And then side B, which is green, we can put right here. And so now we have this triangle right here. And so we can actually, in fact, erase this triangle. You're no longer seeing it there. So we have our triangle here. Bhaskara then took this triangle up here and moved it down here. So we have this side. It's a little bit better. And so this is blue, so this is side A. And so this is in fact side A as well. And we can call this B. And then remember, this is A as well. So now we can erase this triangle. It is no longer there. We have moved it to the bottom. We can keep that as A. This is labeled A. Where are all our A's? This is A. And then we can actually make this square right here. This is an A by A square. Right? Because this side's A. So this side's A. This side is also A. And this entire thing is... this entire thing right here is BA. This entire side is BA. And we can switch these two guys. So let's remove this C, it's annoying. We can remove this B, and remove this A, and we can say that this is in fact this side right here is in fact A. And this entire side from here to here is B. This is B, and the entire thing is BA, so we're still correct here. A, B. And now we have A, B by B square right here. If I shade this entire thing in, you can see that this is B by B. This entire side is also B. Need that. And now we have two squares, a b by b square and an a by a square. And this entire thing represents our original c by c square. Just to make that clear, we had our original square. Remember, it was white. And we said each side was the same. Each angle was 90 degrees. And we labeled each side c. And c times c equals c squared. And this entire thing, this entire thing is a c by c square. Even though we rearranged everything using right triangles. And now what do we have? We have, I'll keep it white. We have b, a b by b. So now we have b times b, which equals b squared, plus another square. This is an a by a square. So a times a equals a squared. And don't forget, we have our original block that represents this entire thing. So we have c times c equals c squared. And what is really going on here? We are just doing a squared plus b squared equals our c squared. And we have proved the Pythagorean theorem using visualization, using squares, the area of a square, the properties of a square that have already been proved in other geometric proofs. And so those axioms allowed us to postulate that the Pythagorean theorem is true. And we are done. Okay, and the last area or topic I want to cover in plane geometry or basic geometry is that of the circle. And now the circle is a fascinating object or shape in that it outputs a value when we try to measure the circumference that we call pi. But pi is just a symbol. So when we try to measure a circle's circumference, so that is the perimeter, really, equal to the perimeter of the circle. This value that we call pi arises. And it's roughly 3.14 with an endless digits. And why is this the case? Well, I think that's a topic for a different video. In fact, I think I've done a video on it called Limits and Continuity. Now, how does this arise? Well, we can physically take a piece of string. Let's say we have a piece of string here, and we have a circle's, let's draw better than that. We have a circle, and we're trying to measure this circle's circumference. We can wrap this string around. We can wrap the string. Around the circle. Then we can take a ruler. Well, first we can lay the string out straight after we wrapped it around and marked the string. So the string wrapped all the way around and we marked it right here. And so let's say that mark, that we marked it, let's say we marked the string right here and then cut the string. We took some scissors and we cut the string. And so now we have the entire string that wrapped around that circle. And we can take a ruler. We got a ruler here, and we measure this string. And it equals some value, and that is the circumference. However, we also need to take this ruler and measure the diameter of the circle. So this line all the way across. Diameter. And with this diameter, we have to plug it into a formula. which is pi is equal to c divided by d. C is our circumference and d is our diameter. So pi equals that line, that string we measured, divided by the diameter that we measured. And depending on how precise you get, you will get closer and closer to 3.14, whatever digits are after that. And there are formulas that allow you to calculate it as well. But that is how you get pi. And of course, this extends to the area of a circle. You can rearrange this using algebra, and you get 2 pi r equals c. D, that's because this right here is the same, is equal to 2 r, or radius times 2. And so 2 pi r equals the circumference. And that's pretty much it. We can also think about the angle of a circle, which is important. So let's say we are measuring using, there's two systems you can use to measure angles. And the one system is degrees, and the other system is radians. These are the two systems to measure angles of any shape, really, but circles more specifically. And then a circle, we say, let's use a different color. A circle, we say, we use is 360 degrees. Really, this number is arbitrary. There's no reason it has to be 360. I think ancient folks used it because there was almost 360 days in a year, or the sun. Really, the earth went around the sun, but to them, the sun went around the earth. And so they used 360 degrees. And now, radians take advantage of pi. And it's more useful to think in radians when you're considering trigonometry, but we aren't going to talk about trigonometry here. But you can think about 360 degrees is going to be 2 pi radians. Radians. So these are equal in value. So we have 360 degrees equals 2 pi radians. Just to make that more clear, what I mean by that is specifically the circle. You're probably familiar with the 360 degrees. But the radians here, this would be 0 radians. Up here would be 1/2 pi. This is pi radians, right? And then we have down here and all the way around. So if we went around completely around this circle, we get 2 pi because we already calculated that, right? 2 pi radians. We calculated that. Where did we calculate that? Right here. We calculated it right here. 2 pi r equals the circumference. The circumference is 2 pi r. And half of the circumference would just be pi radians. And then half pi is half or a quarter of the circle. And so that's kind of how we got this value here. Now that we know both of these, we can actually use algebra once more to do some dimensional analysis and some conversions. So we could say if we divide by 2 pi, we divide both sides by 2 pi, we get, how do I want to write this? Divide by 2 pi divide by 2 pi, we get 180 degrees over pi, and that is equal to 1 radian, right? Because we got rid of this 2 pi, so all we have is radians left. It's really just 1 radian, and we brought it on this side, did the same thing. 360 divided by 2 is 180, and we still have the pi left over.